we're kind of ignoring the storylines of Terminators 3 through 5. This doesn't come from kind of any sense of ego on my part. When I stepped into this project, Tim Miller, the director, and David Ellison, the producer who owned the rights, actually wanted to do that, and they proposed that to me, and I said, "Hey guys, look, that makes total sense to me. Now, can we bring Sarah back?" And so that became the big question. And interestingly, my contribution to this, one of my early contributions, was to ask them to continue with Arnold, because there had been some discussion about the fact that, well, maybe we needed a whole new set of characters and so on. And I said, look, I'd love to be involved with this, but I can't be involved in a Terminator movie without working with my good friend of 35 years, Arnold Schwarzenegger, even if it's to sort of officially pass the baton to a new generation of characters. And so that's what we all agreed to do. So our young victim in this film is Natalia Reyes. She plays Dani Ramos. She's the equivalent of Sarah Connor working at, as a waitress at a Bob's, she's just kind of blue collar, every person, nothing special, doesn't think she's anything special, but she's obviously of great significance in the future. Why? And I think we brought to life a character who's really, really interesting and compelling. We've got Mackenzie Davis's character, Grace, and I'm not going to say too much about Grace. Is she good? Is she bad? She's definitely not entirely human. How human is she? You got to watch the movie to find out, but she's pretty interesting. She's a pretty interesting character as well. You throw them in the mix with Arnold and Linda, and I'm not going to say too much about Arnold's T-800. Is he good? Is he bad? Is he both? The one thing I will say is that we spent a lot of time making him probably the most interesting Terminator T-800 that you've seen yet. And he does have a couple of pretty good funny lines as well, as only Arnold can do. We spent a lot of time on our new nemesis from the future. I'm not going to say too much about his powers and capabilities and so on, but he's pretty damn spectacular. He's played by Gabriel Luna, and the character name is Rev 9. There was a Rev 8 and a Rev 7. They weren't as bad. This guy's the bad one, and we spent a fair bit of time on his design, and I think he's going to impress. I think tonally, what makes this a direct sequel to T1 and T2 is as much about the tone as it is about the narrative. It's R-rated, it's grim, it's gritty, it's fast, it's intense, it's very linear. The whole story takes place in 36 hours. It's not this kind of grandiose, complex story. It's just very focused on the characters, it's very now, it's very present. And it's just a fast white knuckle ride through a kind of techno hell that comes to our present day. So it follows very much tonally in the footsteps of those first two films. And so I think that's one of the victories of this new film, is it's recaptured that tone, that intensity, that take no prisoners feeling, that adrenaline rush feeling, that sense of terror. Terminator, the first film, was supposed to be scary. It was supposed to scare the crap out of you, about a dark future, and just about the survival of this girl that we come to care about. And we've tried to recapture and kind of rebottle that feeling, and not get too grandiose and too complex and have a lot of characters jumping backward and forward through time and all that sort of thing. It's set in our present. It deals with the proximal threat of the human collision with a potential artificial superintelligence, which frankly is a whole lot less science fiction today than it used to be, back in 1984 when I started this. Back in 1984, it was a science fiction fantasy. Now it's actually something that we might seriously face. We pick up the characters that we knew from Terminator 2 and we carry them forward. What does Sarah do the day after Judgment Day didn't happen? Okay, we change the future. It's possible to do. But with that comes the responsibility for the future that took its place, right? So the principle of our movie is that there is an inevitable conflict between humans and the intelligent machines that they make. And all she's done is kick the can down the road from her future back in the 80s to our future now in 2019. Judgment Day is right around the corner yet again. And so really working on script with David Goyer and then with Billy Ray, trying to get the sound of the characters, try to imagine the scenes, how they'll play out. Gave that script to Tim, and then, you know, I would say this is Tim's film. This is Tim's film. He ran with that script. He executed on it beautifully. I believe utterly as producer in the sanctity of the director's creative process with the actors and with the cinematographer, with the production designer, and so on. So, you know, my job, I believe, was to tee this up and set it in motion and let them do their thing.
Hey there, here's today's daily fact. That slightly scandalous charcoal drawing of a topless Kate Winslet in Titanic was drawn by none other than the director himself, James Cameron. Now, if you want something done right, sometimes you just need to do it yourself. Now, remember to click here below to subscribe for more content, or on the side to watch another video.